By the end of this tutorial series, you would have learned to create a spatial map of your environment and develop experiences like AR multi-user, indoor navigation, use BIM models to overlay hidden pipes, and even create a WebXR experience. I know that sounds a lot, but don't worry, it's really easy and you'll be happy to hear that it just takes 3 simple steps to get it done. Step number 1 is to map your room. Step number 2 is to place the virtual content and write a bit of code. Step number 3 is to build the application. So in today's video, we'll start from the basics of mapping our room using Immersal SDK to place the virtual content, and we'll also see how to create persistent spatial anchors. Although we'll be targeting our build for Android phones, you can make small changes to the project settings and build it for other devices like iOS and other AR headsets like Magic Leap, HoloLens or Xreal. Now before we get started, I'd like to thank Immersal for sponsoring this video and for their support. For those of you who don't know Immersal, it's a company that develops technology like spatial mapping and virtual positioning that enables developers like us to create some cool AR experiences like the ones that you saw earlier. Alright then, I'm super excited to teach you all of this. Let's get started. To create a map of your environment, you need to download the Immersal Mapper app either from the Google Play Store or from the App Store. Now while this app is getting downloaded, you can visit developers.immersal.com and create an account. Later, you'll be using the same credentials to log in inside the Immersal app and also while developing inside Unity. Once you have the application downloaded and logged in, you can create a new map by pressing on this button. And here on the top right corner, you'll be able to see two modes, the manual mode and the real-time mode. In manual mode, you'll have to take the pictures of the target area by yourself from different positions and angles and upload the images to the server for map construction, which will then create the point clouds for you. But in the real-time mode, you can just press the record button and move around inside the target area. It will capture the images automatically and generate the point clouds in real time. So now the question is, which mode do you choose? Well, if you're looking for a higher quality map, or if you're looking to map complex areas, then you can choose manual mode as it provides better results. However, it requires more careful mapping as it's easy to miss certain angles or transitions. On the other hand, you can use real mode for testing or for mapping small areas as it generates the point clouds on the fly, but it does not save the images or generate a mesh of your environment. Now for this video, I used manual mode to capture my studio room. Once the map construction is done, you can download the map and even localize it in AR to check its quality. If it is able to localize within a few attempts, you'll know that you have a good quality map. Now, if you use real-time mode to capture your environment, then make sure to upload the map to the cloud. Next, you can go to the Immersal's developer portal, click on View Your Maps, and here it will give you a list of all the maps that you have captured. And then if you click on the 3-dot, it gives you options to view the sparse poly, the dense poly, or the GLB. Now, if it gives you the option just to view the sparse poly, then it means that your map quality is not so good and it does not have enough number of feature points to generate a dense poly or a GLB. Now, there could also be cases where you are able to view the sparse poly and the dense poly, but when you try to view the GLB, it says something like mesh failed. Once again, it means that the quality of your map is not so good that it can generate a GLB file. Alright, now that you know how to create a map and view it, let's now see how to use it to create AR experiences. Let's start by creating a new Unity project. Here, make sure to use the editor version 22.3 LTS or above. You can select 3D Core Render Pipeline, give your project a name and create a project. Once you have your project open, we can add the Immersal SDK by navigating inside Windows, Package Manager, click on the plus symbol, select Add Package from Git URL and paste the URL here, which you can find in the description below, and click on Add. During installation, you'll get a warning saying that the project is using new input system but it's not enabled. So to enable it, click on Yes. Once you have the SDK installed, you'll see the Immersal project validation window, which will show you some of the recommended settings. But these settings are specific to a target platform. So before we fix them, navigate inside File, Build Settings. And here I'll be selecting Android as my build platform. Now if you're building it for iOS, you can select iOS and switch the platform. And now you can click on Fix All to apply the recommended settings. However, there's one issue that you will have to fix manually, and that is to set AR Core as the XR plugin provider. And to do that, click on Fix and select Google AR Core as the plugin provider. Alright, so with that we have our project set up. Next, let's set up our scene. Here we can select the main camera and delete it, and then right click on your hierarchy. Navigate inside XR and add AR session and add XR origin. The AR session component takes care of the entire life cycle of an AR experience on your device, and the AR input manager enables world tracking. Now if you open the child object of XR origin and select main camera and scroll down, here you'll see the track pose driver. Now this component is responsible for getting the position and rotation of your device, and then the XR origin will use this data to transform the trackable objects and its features to final position inside the Unity scene. Next, to download the spatial map and use the VPS features to place virtual content, in your project window, search for Immersive. Make sure the search is selected to all. Select the Immersal SDK prefab and add it to your scene. This prefab comes with the AR Foundation support, which is responsible for configuring the device and getting the required camera data. Then it has two different type of localization method, which define how the localization should happen. And it has the localizer component that configure and manages these two different type of localization methods. Next, we have the scene updater component, which takes the position from the localizer, adjusts it if required, and updates the scene accordingly. Next, the tracking analyzer component is responsible for interpreting the data such as device status and localization result. And based on this interpretation, is going to construct a tracking status to describe the quality of positioning. And finally, we have the Immersal Session component, which forms a pipeline by connecting all these different type of components together. It manages a continuous loop by getting the required data from different components and processes it based on some internal logic and configuration. Next, create an empty game object and call it as XR Space. It is this game object inside which we'll be placing the spatial map and all the virtual component. So select the game object and add the XR Space component to it. It needs data processor, so we can create two data processor, one for smoothing the pose, another for filtering the pose. So right click on XR Space and create an empty game object and call it as pose filter, and add the pose filter component to it. Similarly, create another empty game object and call it as pose smoother and add the pose smoother component to it. Then we can select XR Space and add the pose filter and pose smoother to this list. Now to download the spatial map, create an empty game object as a child of XR Space, call it as XR Map, and add the XR Map component to it. Now in order to download the map from the cloud, we'll have to first log in inside Immersal SDK. You can use the same credentials that you used to create the account. On logging in successfully, you'll be able to see a token here, and then you can go to the Immersal's developer portal, copy the map ID, go back inside Unity, and here you can paste the map ID. Make sure to check map file, visualization, and click on download. Alright, so here I have my map downloaded. I can easily recognize the different features of my room here. For example, this is my laptop. Here I have my camera. Here I have my studio lighting. This is my table. This is the rest of my room. And here I can see my bed as well. Now you can select the XR map and decide if you want the localization method to be device localized or server localized. And similarly, you can decide if you want the map data to be embedded or downloaded. Then if you select its child object, which has the XR map visualizer, here you can select the render mode from Unity editor to editor and runtime. You can change the point color if you'd like to, and you can even modify its size. And now we can save this scene and build and test it onto a device. First, you need to make sure that you have the developer's mode enabled on your device, then connect it to your laptop or computer. Navigate inside File, Build Settings, add the open scene, and from the drop-down, you should be able to see your device and click on Build and Run. Create a new folder and call it as Builds. Give your file a name and click on Save. Alright, so here I have the application, and as you can see, in a couple of seconds, the spatial map got localized and it matches exactly with the physical environment. Now that we know the app is able to localize the spatial map, let's see how to add virtual content. First, right-click on XR Space and create an empty game object and call it as Content. Then, navigate inside Windows Package Manager, select Immersal SDK, go inside the Samples tab and import the core samples. Then, navigate inside Asset, Samples, Immersal SDK, the version, core samples, prefabs, content placement, and here you can find the AR diamond, which you can select and drag and drop it inside the content. And now, you can move this and align it with your spatial map. So for now, I'm going to place this diamond right above my camera here like this. And then I'm going to duplicate it and place one more diamond somewhere at the side of the laptop here like this. Now if you don't want to see the point clouds in your application anymore, you can navigate inside XR Map, select its child object and set the render mode to editor only. And then you can save your scene and build this application once again. So here I have my build, and as you can see, after the first successful localization, the placements of the diamonds are the same as that we set up inside Unity. I think it would make sense to show the number of localization and show how good the tracking quality is. So to add that, we can create a UI canvas. Then navigate inside Samples, Immersal SDK, the version, Core Samples, Prefabs, Utilities, And from here, we can select the localization status text and the pose indicator and drag and drop them inside the canvas. And here it will ask you to import the Text Mesh Pro Essentials. So let's do that. And now here it will show you the number of successful localization versus the number of times it has attempted to localize. And on the left top corner, it will show you how good the tracking quality is. All right, now let's see how to create spatial anchors that are persistent. What I mean by that is, you'll be able to create a spatial anchor and exit the application. And then when you reopen the application, it will spawn the virtual content in the exact same position that you had left it. To implement this, I've written a script called as instantiate spatial anchor, which you can download from the link below. In this script, first we want to declare a serializable structure that has variables to store a list of position and rotation. Then we want to declare variables to store the game object of the anchor, the transform of the camera, and the transform of the XR space content. Then we create variables to store the list of anchor's position and rotation. Then we create an instance of the structure and a string variable to store the file name. Then we can create a method to instantiate the prefab and spawn it at a distance slightly ahead of the camera and place it as a child of the XR space content. And then save the anchor's position, rotation, and save the anchor data inside the device's memory. For that, we can create another method called saveContent, which is going to access the anchor's position and rotation, convert it into a JSON file, get the data path, and write the JSON file inside that data path. Next, we can write a function to load the content, where it's going to start from a clean slate. It's going to get the data path and try to load a file. Now, if the file is found, then it's going to instantiate the anchor based on its position and rotation saved inside your device memory. If there's no file found, then it's going to tell you, hey, a file is not found, please create one. Now, since we want to instantiate the anchor based on position and rotation, we can create a variation of the instantiate anchor where it takes the position and rotation and spawns it accordingly. And finally, in the start method, we can load the content. So here we are back in Unity. Let's first navigate inside XR space and remove these two diamonds that we added earlier. Then inside the canvas, we can create a UI button. Adjust its scale and position, and you can rename the button text to spawn anchor. Then you can add the instantiate spatial anchor script to the button and scroll down and add the references. For the anchor prefab, we can search for AR diamond inside the asset folder and add that. For the camera transform, you can navigate inside XR origin, select main camera and reference it here. Similarly, for the XR space content, select content and reference it here. Then add an item to the onclick event. Select instantiate spatial anchor script, drag and drop it in here, and from the drop down, we want to select instantiate anchor. And that's about it. Now you can save the scene and build it. Now to test the application, wait for it to localize a couple of times before you spawn the anchors and quit the application. Then when you reopen the application, wait for it. Once it localizes for the first time, it will spawn the anchors in the exact same location that you had in the previous session. So now that you know the basic concept of creating spatial maps, placing virtual content and creating spatial anchors, you're now ready for the next step, which is creating AR pathfinding, aka indoor navigation. I will leave a link for that video somewhere on this page. Now, before we end this video, if you're wondering how to set up this project for Magic Leap 2 or Unreal or even iOS, they have a very nice documentation. I will leave a link for that in the description. And that's it for this video. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to like and subscribe, and I will see you in the next one.